Well, Jim, next time we get together, you'll be sporting one of these missile badges yourself. Your countdown started, ready, boy.
Sure looks that way, but I've been a bomber man so long that it's just not going to be easy.
Changes never are easy. We've broken through enough of them over the years to know that.
Yeah, and it's taken me more years than I like to recall just to keep up with aircraft. Now they're throwing a missile squad into my lap. What do I know about missiles?
You learn, Jim. It wasn't too many months back that I was standing in your shoes. I learned. I had to.
Now it's my turn, huh?
Yours and a lot of others. One thing's certain, the ballistic missile is here to stay. Except that fact. Well, maybe things will fit in a place a little easier. Anyhow, good luck, Jim.
So long, Ed.
This is it, Colonel. The day you've been expecting for a long time. You've taken your first step to becoming a full-fledged missile commander. No, the men and the missiles won't be here for a while yet. But that'll give you time. Time to think. Time to plan. Time to find the answers to those questions that are racing through your mind at this moment. There she goes. Just another jet taking off from a base that's become as familiar to you as your own backyard. You can expect to see some mighty unfamiliar things around this backyard in the next year. Yes, you'll see more changes than you ever dreamed possible. And problems? You can bet you'll stay awake nights thinking about them. But you've managed to lick problems before. And whether you realize it now or not, you'll find yourself relying on this past experience to lick the so-called bugaboos associated with the ballistic missile. Let's look at a ballistic missile. Let's find out what makes it tick. Not just any missile, but the Atlas Intercontinental Ballistic Missile. The particular one you'll soon be concerned with. This is Atlas. No longer yesterday's test rocket, but a part of SAC's deterrent force today. A 1.5-stage, 132-ton ballistic device, now fully operational, after an evolutionary background of more than 50 years of powered flight. Its lightweight stainless steel airframe houses a baffling network of wires, ducting, and delicate instruments. Its sensitive guidance and control system is capable of directing Atlas with uncanny accuracy to a pinpoint target over 5,500 nautical miles away. And these sophisticated high-performance rocket engines combine to produce an entirely new breed of vehicle. But like the bomber without its thermonuclear payload, it's this re-entry vehicle that gives real meaning to Atlas. This warhead is designed to safely send its bomb package through the violent shock of re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere to a selected enemy target. Now let's take a closer look at the other three basic parts that make up this missile. This is the Atlas airframe under assembly at the factory. A thin, unsupported stainless steel shell, yet strong enough to keep the missile and its components intact and functional under extreme, rapidly changing stresses and strains. Here are the powerful Atlas rocket engines in action. These two main thrust chambers with the sustainer engine between them are capable of providing far more thrust than is necessary to lift Atlas from its launcher. The two small vernier engines furnish missile roll control during powered flight. Final velocity and position adjustments after the sustainer engine has been stopped. All Atlas engines are in operation during the boost phase, lasting approximately 130 seconds. When the booster thrust section is jettisoned, the sustainer and verniers continue to perform. At a program point, the sustainer shuts off, and only the vernier engines continue to operate, allowing ground guidance to make any final adjustments in the missile's course and velocity. At vernier cutoff, the warhead is separated from the missile by means of retro rockets and continues its ballistic trajectory to the target. Most of the Atlas guidance components do not fly with the bird. They remain here on the ground within the Radio Inertial Guidance Systems building. Only these canisters and actuators are built into the missile. Locked in flight to ground radar, they are provided with radio guidance signals during the first 400 to 500 miles of flight and guide Atlas with sufficient accuracy to result in an acceptable CEP. Unlike the all bomber command, your missile squadron will require no need for target studies. Every Atlas target has been pre-selected, often while the missile itself is still undergoing assembly at the factory. Here at the SAC Trajectory Computation Center at Offutt Air Force Base, Nebraska, the IBM 704 produces all target trajectory pre-computations. This information is then fed to every operational unit where proper target settings are made in the missile guidance computers. Aside from its primary target, each Atlas is provided with alternate target settings. Should intelligence report the destruction of a prime target before missile launch, SAC control will authorize the use of one of these alternates. Now let's take a Cook's tour of an Atlas missile base. For many months, the once quiet prairie has echoed to the rumble of giant steam shovels and earth movers. Dirt roads and cattle trails have been replaced with modern highways, wide ribbons of concrete linking the support base to remote missile sites. Here, construction crews work round the clock, giving real shape to technical facilities, which 10 years ago existed only in science fiction. And working right along with the contractors are men like Major Ted Dixon, an Air Force Ballistic Missile Division field representative. He and his staff of competent troubleshooters set up shop long before the first bulldozer arrived. Their job? To coordinate the activities of all contractors during construction, installation, and checkout, and to accept the completed facilities for turnover to SAC. From this eagle's eye view, we see a 1x3 Atlas complex, a soft site configuration, just one of three identical complexes at this base, each maintaining three missiles, and each separated by a distance of about 18 miles. Your base will contain buried or hardened missile sites with far greater dispersal than this complex. Dispersal, forcing the enemy to extend his target system to the point where it far exceeds his capacity to destroy SAC's entire retaliatory strike force in a surprise missile attack. This launch and service building, nearly identical to the hardened structure, is to the missile what the protective maintenance hangar is to the bomber. Within this service structure, an Atlas missile waits, combat ready, horizontally mated and locked to its launcher at the T-minus 15 condition. A safe distance from the launch and service structure is the launch operations building. Inside its main operations room, the launch control officer and his crew, working in shifts, maintain continuous 24-hour duty at their panels, ready to instantly begin an active countdown. From his raised platform, the launch control officer can observe all activities within the control room. The status panel in front of him tells at a glance the condition of the missile and its associated support equipment. With the command to launch, an active countdown begins. The roof of the launch and service building rolls back automatically. The missile raises slowly, deliberately, to its firing position. Not far away in the missile guidance building, the guidance control officer and his technicians monitor the radio inertial guidance system. The brains of the guidance system is this electronic computer. Stored within its metallic shell is a mass of previously calculated trajectory information for both the prime and alternate missile targets. was launched. Surface radar equipment, tied to the computer, measures speed, rate of change, and position of the missile. After evaluating this information, the computer sends corrective commands to Atlas. At the instant when missile speed, heading, and angle of elevation are correct, the computer issues the final engine cutoff signal. Atlas is now free from all guidance controls, and the computer is free to send another Atlas to its destination. Although most of your missile facilities will be found many miles from the support base, there will still be some new buildings you can see right from your office window. The squadron maintenance area, for example, an immense structure of steel and concrete, and first stop for each Atlas arriving at your base. Inside this vast building, every system and subsystem of each missile must be periodically checked out, tested with routine regularity to maintain operational readiness. Comprising the major portion of this weapon checkout apparatus is APSHE, Automatic Program Checkout Equipment, an electromechanical brain designed to initiate test sequences and to evaluate all test results. With each measured rhythmic tick and each flash of a panel light, a specific test is being performed.